What's up, guys? This is what we're going to be creating today. So let's start with black text. You can download the font from this website. I'm going to drop a grunge layer down into the bottom here, and I'm going to drop the opacity pretty low just to start. I'm going to create a new solid, name it OF for optical flares. We'll drop the optical flares effect on there from Video Copilot. We'll choose this preset to start and bring up the interface. I'm going to get rid of everything but the glow. And now we have two glows, and I'm just going to increase the scale so that it's brighter and it has a wider spread. I'm also going to change the color to match this warm color that they had in the trailer. I'm going to change the position of the flare so it's behind the text in a similar position to where it was in the trailer. And I'm going to create a white solid, turn the opacity down to zero for now, and drop that below the text layer. With the white solid layer selected, I'm going to cut a mask around roughly the area where the core of the glow is, and I'll turn the opacity back up to 100, and feather the mask a touch to soften the edge. I'll create a new adjustment layer, put that above the white solid, and rename it Volumetric Effect. Then I'll add a CC Fast Radial Blur to the adjustment layer. I'll change the zoom to brightest, position the center at the core of the glow, so right in the middle of the white solid, and turn up the amount for the blur. You'll notice that we're not really getting a volumetric effect that takes the text into account, and that's because the adjustment layer with the glow on it is actually below the text layer so it doesn't see it. So you have to place that adjustment layer with the glow on it on top of everything, including the text layer. Now because we have it set to brightest, the text won't glow because it's black, but the white solid underneath will, and this will create a volumetric effect where it looks like the light is passing through behind the letters in this foggy environment. You'll notice the effect looks too strong and you can't read the text at all, and that's because the blur layer needs to be set to screen. Once you do that, you'll be able to read the text. If you lower the opacity of the white solid layer, you can affect the volumetric strength of the core, and if you lower the opacity of the blur layer, you can adjust the strength of the overall volumetric effect. Now I'm going to add a new adjustment layer with a glow to kind of soften some of the hard edges that we're seeing here, and to get a little bit more overlap of the light onto the letters. I'm noticing that we're not really seeing the grungy background layer, so I'm going to bring up the opacity a little bit, and then I'm going to drop a black solid at the bottom so we're not seeing that transparency, and in the final render, we won't have that transparency to the background. If I move the center point around of the blur effect, you can see the volumetric effect happening there. It's a little bit of a hard edge, especially on the H, so I'm just going to add a fast box blur and set it very low just to soften that edge a little bit. And here I'm just making some fine-tuned adjustments to the strength of the volumetric effect by adjusting the opacity of both the core layer and also the CC fast radial blur. And inside of optical flares, I'm just going to add a tiny bit of a flicker by changing the speed to 2 and the amount to 25. And this will give us a little bit of a light flicker from the core of the volumetrics. Here, I dropped down a hue and saturation effect as well as a curves effect and a vignette. And so I'm just giving this a little bit more contrast, a little bit more color, and I'm putting a vignette around the layers so that the edges fall into darkness, especially over on the right side. And if you were wondering, the vignette is just a black solid with a custom mask on it, cut around the layers to make sure the edges fall into darkness. Obviously, heavily feathered, so there's a gradual transition into darkness, and I also played with the opacity to get it looking the way I wanted to. I'm going to create a new adjustment layer, and I'm going to put the film look and the film grain onto this layer. I'm also going to make an adjustment to the color temperature using the wheels. I'm going to take the midtones and shift them more toward a warm tone, slightly red, in order to shift this color tone more in line with what was in the trailer. And I'm just going to make some adjustments here to the softness of the overall image. Film Convert has a nice softening filter, so I just turn that up, and then I adjust some of the contrast and the color to get some of that richness in color as well as contrast. Here I have a couple of dust effects from Rampant Design. Now the problem with these is that they're colored, so what I have to do is tint them so that they're black and white, so just remove all the saturation. And then another thing is that these particles move a little bit too quickly, so I'm going to have to slow them down a significant amount. So I'll stretch them out and then also turn on pixel motion so that we get smooth motion, not any blurred particles or streaks that can sometimes happen if you're using something like frame interpolation or something like that. And here I'm just adding an extra spores layer in front of the text, so we have spores passing behind the text and also in front for added depth. In order to get a flashlight looking beam, I'm going to add a glint, and then I'm going to decrease the completion and then increase the completion feather so that I can feather the edges a little bit so that the edges won't be so sharp. Then I'm going to add a glint to act as the source, and it sort of has this star pattern, which you can see in the trailer as well. So that just kind of mimics the bulb or the source and the way it hits the lens. I'm going to put the beam into place here, which is right behind the A, and I'm going to add a fade in to the volumetric effects so that those effects kind of fade in, but we start in the darkness with the flashlight by itself, and then the volumetric effects kind of fade in and kick in as they do in the trailer. We're going to have to create a matte for the flashlight layer because we want it passing behind the A, but then coming through the middle hole in the A and then overlapping the rest of the letters as if it's shooting from above down through the hole in the A and then in front of the rest of the letters. So we have to create a mat. We'll duplicate the text layer, mask around the A, and then create a feathered edge so the edge isn't so sharp and we have a more realistic fall off on the edges there. So now when we move it, you can see that it looks like the light is kind of traveling, shooting through the hole in the A and coming out the front. Now, obviously we can't go too far because then you'll see the effect of the mask. But if we restrict ourselves to that small range of movement, we should be okay. And then we can also rotate it by using the rotation offset. So we'll keyframe that and animate that flashlight so it looks like it's kind of looking around. So it's starting down, and as it moves up, it kind of moves over toward the right of the screen, as if the person holding it is tilting it. And when the volumetrics kick in, that's when the flashlight effect fades out, almost as if it's overpowered by the bright light that's turning on in the scene. Because we're animating it up behind the H, we have to create a mat so it travels behind the H as well. So we'll just mask around this section of the H and soften the edges so we don't get any hard edges and we have a more realistic fall off. This is sort of a brute force approach, but if we know what we're going for, then we can definitely make it work. Another thing we can do is create a black solid and mask these areas here so that the only thing visible when only the flashlight is on is the immediate area around the flashlight. And then we can keyframe the opacity of this layer to fade out when the brighter volumetrics kick in. Another thing we can do is create a white solid in the shape of the hole in the H. And then we can apply the same effect that we did to the light source core layer, which is our white solid that we cut a mask around to make it that strange background shape where the light is emitting from. And then with the CC radial fast blur position controller, we can kind of control the beam that's generated from that white solid behind the hole in the H. Make sure with this new white solid layer that's in the shape of the hole in the A that you switch the transfer mode to add or screen. So just for clarity, I have two radial fast blur effects going on here. I have one controlling the light coming out of the A, and then that fades out. And while that's fading out, the radial fast blur that's controlling the overall light core you see in the background there, that one kicks in and takes over for the rest of the animation. And so what I've done here is keyframe the position of the center point of the radial fast blur so that the movement of the light streak coming out of the A matches the rotational movement of the flashlight beam. So all tied together, this is what it looks like. And then I just have to add a fade out at the end. These titles are a little bit easier because they're just meant to be more basic, because one's a tagline and the other's a release date, so it's really just conveying information. So you just really need to be able to read them, but we want to add a little bit more style than just throwing up text on the screen. So I'll make this text a 3D layer and I'll add a spotlight. I'm also going to add a point light, and that's going to be used as sort of an ambient light for fill, just in case the edges get too dark. I'll feather the edges of the spotlight so we get a large fall off, and I'll aim the spotlight at the center of the text. What we're aiming for here is to get fall off at the edges of the text, but not a sharp fall off, a very gradual fall off, so it looks like there's a gradient on either side of the text. So you can see as I move the light closer and further away, that increases or decreases the intensity, but now I need to widen the cone and then feather the edges quite a bit so that we can get that fall off I was talking about. That gives the text a little bit more depth than just a block of text that's one color. Here you can see I've also added a little bit of movement to the text, so I just scaled it up slightly so that the text has a little bit of motion. I've also keyframed the cone angle so that the edges of the text fall into darkness once it fades up, but then the cone widens and therefore the light source widens, and then you can read the rest of the text, but the edges of the text still have that fall off. Now here I'm noticing that the fade up and the fade out and the amount of time that the text is on screen is a little bit too long, so I'm just going to adjust the timing of that by moving the keyframes. And then finally I'm going to take one of the spores layers, throw it in front of the text, and adjust the mask so it's covering the front of the entire block of text and not just the center portion. And what that's going to do is create the illusion that the light source, whether it's the flashlight or a spotlight or whatever it is shining on the text, and that light is also illuminating the spores that are in the environment. But you can't see them around the edges because there's no light there. And to add even more depth, you can duplicate the spores layer or add another spores layer and put it underneath the text so that some of the spores are traveling in front of the text and some of the spores are traveling behind the text. And that'll give it more depth. And for the last title, it's the same deal, but in order to give it a little bit more depth, I actually had the light come from above and have the gradient toward the edges, but also toward the bottom. And I just animate the light from higher up to a little bit lower or right in front of the text, and that just gives us a different variation on the reveal of the date. So we have a little bit of fall off on the sides, but also a lot of fall off on the bottom, and we don't get the same exact fade in that we do for the tagline. Here I'm also putting in another spores layer, and I'm adjusting the mask so that the spores end up in front of the text. Again, we're going with the concept that there's a light shining on the text, and that light source is illuminating the spores in the environment. But since the light source is only concentrated on the text, we only see spores around that area. So we have to bring in the mask in order to essentially shrink down that light source. And that's it, guys. So hit me up on social media if you have any questions, or hit me up on email, paul@pauldv.net. Stay tuned next week, as we're going to be adding ivy to this building, and we're going to put a large hole in the roof. So speaking of The Last of Us, this next one is inspired by it. So stay tuned for that. If you like this video, please like and subscribe. It really does help when you guys do that, so I can continue bringing you more of these tutorials and more videos like this and more short films. Once again, my name is Paul DelVecchio. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.